the smartest film critic in the world, Cole Smithy.
Hi, this is Cole Smithy with ColeSmithy.com, and your guide to what to see and what to avoid at the movies this week.
You think that you could actually kill somebody?
Calamity is the kind of low-budget suspense thriller that gives indies a bad name.
Who really knows? Me and my friends, we were just looking for some young ladies to keep us company.
You make us sound like hookers.
Oh, no, I didn't.
Without the anchoring effect that actor Nick Stahl has on the film, writer-director James M. Hausler would not have even a watchable movie. Billy, played by Stahl, has recently broken up with his girlfriend when he returns to his hometown of Fairfax, Virginia, to spend time with his poker-faced buddy Christian, played by Christopher M. Clark, and tightly wound best friend Stanley, played by Jonathan Jackson. Stanley, too, has an ex-girlfriend skeleton in his recent past.
The search begins for a young woman of 24. Her name is Ashley Detweiler.
We all make rash decisions.
When a local girl goes missing, it seems possible that the misogynistic Stanley might have added a real skeleton to his closet of secrets. A symptom of putting an experienced actor like Nick Stahl in a fishbowl indie movie like Calamity is that it clearly exposes weaknesses in other cast members. Christopher M. Clark's abysmal performance tarnishes every half-written scene where he appears.
You hear me? We're friends. You're making me feel crazy here, Stan.
You think you're crazy?
No. I thought I could fix what
I'm doing. What does this mean?
As his misspelled title indicates, James N. Hausler is not ready for his close-up or for a feature film. I give this poor effort a D. I've got some
news for you. Planeta, todos los revolucionarios juntos luchando al mismo tiempo.
How long have you been with us?
You are still a boy. I need men.
So you don't trust me because I'm young?
You have to prove yourself.
The condensed 2.5-hour version of director Olivier Assayas' 3-part miniseries about one of the most notorious terrorists of the 20th century is so engrossing it will send some audience members in search of the full 5.5-hour version.
I weighed already the pros and cons of the entire situation.
Like you, I strongly believe that the Palestinian struggle should take on an international level.
I will be honored to contribute some of my modest skills.
More of a fact-based espionage thriller than a biopic, Carlos fits comfortably alongside similar cinematic efforts at grappling with controversial revolutionaries as with Steven Soderbergh's Che Guevara epic, Che. Assayas' adaptness with handling period style and social subtext is on display with a sense of informed whimsy that comes across in his choice of 70s and 80s punk and synth music. When the Dead Boys' sonic reducer comes blasting through a car radio, it has a profound effect on the film's pedal-to-the-metal attitude. Assayas charts the transformation of Venezuelan activist Ilich Ramirez Sanchez, played by Edgar Ramirez, into his terrorist identity of Carlos, following his pro-Palestinian efforts in Jordan, London, and Paris.
The next OPEC meeting, we will take the ministers hostage.
You're brave.
You fear for your life!
I'm a soldier! I'm not a martyr!
Look at you! You are a wreck!
The Cold War is over.
You are a historical curiosity.
The nail-biting centerpiece is Carlos's 1975-led seizure of the OPEC headquarters, where he and his 6 militant team take hostage over 60 ministers and delegates. Edgar Ramirez's fleshy portrayal of the enigmatic Carlos is a mesmerizing high-wire act of incredible precision. For as much as it might seem the film's dramatic liberties canonize the terrorist that the British press dubbed the Jackal, Carlos is a character study that comes warts and all. The film shows a glimpse of the global forces at play that enabled a power vacuum that a unique man was able to capitalize on for a surprisingly long period of time. Carlos's egotism, fatalism, and hypocritical desires are dissected with an artistic scalpel.
Wherever you go, they will find you.
Living under cover, the fear, the loneliness.
How do you expect it to end?
An overriding subtext relates what an amateur Carlos was compared with corporate powers that hold far more hostages and make much steeper demands. Don't miss Carlos. I give this outstanding action biopic an A.
Here in Mexico, we live in a war zone. The murder rate is 3 times that of the US. What is wrong with using dead people to save other people's lives?
Pockmarked with cliches, director Baltazar Cormacore's action suspense drama comes up short in every category.
Chloe is entering stage 4.
That's the final stage, right?
I'm gonna take some time off. My daughter's not doing too well.
We just found out we have a possible donor.
Paul, played by Dermot Mulroney, and Diane, played by Diane Kruger, are a married couple with a 10-year-old daughter in desperate need of a lung transplant. A tip from an ethically challenged doctor, played by Rosanna Arquette, sends Paul on a solo mission to Mexico to arrange for a black market lung transplant for daughter Chloe.
I just want to save my daughter's life.
Organ tourism. If you are in need and have money, there are options.
An illegal transplant.
The movie is all over the place. Paul doesn't make for the most responsible patriarchal protagonist, and every exaggerated plot point comes with a neon flashing sign to announce it. Sam Shepard puts in a welcome overqualified cameo to deposit some capital letter exposition from 2 screenwriters who should never be heard from on the big screen again.
We've secured a donor. Did you expect the perfect match to die within 12 hours?
Care where they found those lungs.
Pull over!
Most unforgivable is the film's hokey third act that goes over the top backwards to show the connection between the recently deceased, i.e. murdered, organ donors and their North American recipients. I give this dreadful movie a D. My sleeper pick for the week is The Two Escobars, and my guilty pleasure pick is David Fincher's The Social Network. My must-have DVDs are The Psycho Legacy from Shout Factory, Tales from the Dark Side, final season from Paramount, and Smash His Camera from Magnolia Home Entertainment.
Elisabeth, förlåt mig! Herregud, jag bär mig åt som en idiot. Jag vet inte vad du tar åt mig. Jag är ju här för att hjälpa dig. Så var det där hemska brevet.
Persona is Ingmar Bergman's 1966 lesbian romantic psychological mystery.
Doktorn ville tala med mig.
Har syster Alma varit inne hos fru Fogler?
Nej, inte ännu.
It's a black and white experimental film that draws on formal theatrical conventions and minimal set designs to observe a complex relationship between an actress named Elizabeth, played by Liv Ullmann, and her full-time nurse, Alma, played by Bibi Anderson. Elizabeth was performing in a stage production of Elektra when she suddenly lost her voice, or her desire to speak. Nurse Alma's unprofessional conversational strategy for getting Elizabeth to talk backfires when Alma drunkenly reveals a deeply intimate story from her past that provokes the women's lust for one another. Bergman's beautifully evocative tableau captures the unpronounced sex act with Anderson and Ullmann staring directly into the camera while Elizabeth caresses Alma. What we experience is a pure distillation of character and action. By reducing the women's shared sensual experience to a dark mirror gaze of the way they view one another, Bergman allows their expression of desire to transcend the scene's dramatic state. As in life, sex changes everything. The women immediately come at odds after mutually pretending that their night of erotic gratification didn't happen, or at least they can't remember it if it did. The magnetic attraction between the uncannily expressive Ullmann and the terrifically physical Anderson provides a constant pulse of organic momentum to propel Bergman's daring artistic liberties. Bergman's objective is to show a duality of nature through which Alma and Elizabeth switch places, psychologically, metaphorically, and physically. Alma's discovery of a betraying letter from Elizabeth to her doctor sets the anti-plot narrative on the temporary trajectory of a suspense thriller. Alma's revenge on Elizabeth reveals Alma's latent S&M desires and pushes the drama into a telling act of psychosexual demonstration. Persona is at once one of the most complex and most simple films ever made.
Jag har inte lärt störa dig. Tror inte jag förstår. Doktorn har förklarat både det ena och det andra.
Bergman's clear-eyed artistic study of the rules of interplay between oppositely ill-equipped, dominant, and submissive characters carries universal ideas about human compatibility. Thanks for watching. Visit ColeSmithy.com for more. Thank you.